Buddy Kaul was a major filmmaker, and there are many here who knew him personally, including me. And when he died of a long illness, we decided to institute a lecture in his memory. The first one was delivered by Kumar Shahani, and for the second one you have Dileep Padgaonkar. Now, Dileep Padgaonkar also knew Buddy Kaul very well, and as you know, he is an eminent journalist, he has been an editor, but more importantly, he has been interested in literature and the arts. He served in the UNESCO, he was the editor of the Times of India, and now he lives in Pune. And although there is no expectation or compulsion in the lecture series that one should speak about the person in whose name the lecture is, he has chosen to speak about Buddy Kaul's cinema. This has been a cinema which has been perhaps not yet adequately critically noticed and analyzed. But that's how things are. There are many serious things which keep on happening in this country, which do not get the kind of critical attention they deserve. There are many trivial things which are blown out of proportion and are noticed. Anyway, that's how it is. This is the world we live in. So we are very happy to welcome Dileep Padgaonkar, and may I say some. Flowers, and then
thank you, Shok. Thank you, Rosa Foundation, for this opportunity. You don't give out the lectures every once in a while, and therefore I was forewarned. And this interval allowed me to go back and see some of the films that Mani did. Fortunately, almost all of them are available on YouTube in a terrible condition, but nevertheless, they're there. To revisit Mani's work 5 years after his death is to realize in a fuller measure the risks he ran to swim against the tide. The brio with which he challenged every norm and convention of filmmaking of his day has few parallels in the history of Indian cinema. His theoretical concerns and interests were not restricted to matters of style and to matters of technique. Mani contested the very basis of cinema, namely that it is primarily a visual medium. He claimed that cinema was in fact a temporal one. Cinema had more to do with the sense of time, of duration, than with space, and that sense of time could be experienced only when images do not overwhelm a film. In fact, one of the characteristics Maniism was visual is vulgar. On the basis of this initial premise, Mani went on to demolish other commonplaces of the cinema. He asserted, for example, that to realize its true potential, cinema must steer clear of any attempt to represent reality, social or political, ideological, religious or psychological. Representation was mere simulacra. And simulacra means a shadowy likeness of or a deceptive substitute for reality. The job of the filmmaker, according to him, is to present, not to represent. For that very reason, Mani was hostile to ideas about unity and cohesiveness in a film. He preferred fragmentation of the narrative over its unity, for this alone, in his view, would allow him to engage with the multiplicity of life with its order and chaos, doubts and certainties coexisting cheek by jowl. In fact, he went much further in this direction. He abandoned anything that had a literal or even a metaphorical meaning. Indeed, the very idea of meaning itself discomforted him. As we shall see in a moment, he often asked what meaning meant in music. Did it mean the presence of a note? Or the absence of a note? Or did it mean the movement of a note on a musical scale? He also wondered what meaning meant when one perceived something in the waking state and something in a dream. The experience in each case is different. Was the meaning of one state weightier than that of the other? Was one state more real than the other? Might in fact rubbish these questions on the ground that all three states of consciousness, waking consciousness, consciousness in a dream, and consciousness in deep sleep, were equally meaningful, equally real. He sought an undifferentiated way to present them in his work. This was equally true of the plots of his films. Many people thought that they were thin, that they lacked logic, they lacked dramatic tension. Money, however, contended that a linear narrative is the biggest curse on a film, since it imposes, and I quote him, repressive constraints on the media.